Have you, or do you know anybody who suffered from cancer? Or are you scared of that disease? Well, I know a lot of people who suffered from cancer, and I'm scared of that disease. And how about infectious disease outbreaks? Are you afraid of that? Well, I'm afraid of that too. But see, I'm a bioengineer. So these diseases and all the other diseases, I see as a problems to which the modern science and engineering can provide solutions. So what if I told you that there is a molecule that can provide instructions to your body that can enable it to fight infectious agents or to replace defective proteins or to fight cancer? That molecule exists. It's called messenger RNA, or mRNA. mRNA is poised to be the next big thing in medicine. It serves as a messenger, taking instructions from our DNA to the parts of the cells that make proteins. Proteins needed for nearly every function in our body. And whether it's replacing missing or misfunctional proteins, or combating cancer cells, mRNA technology can provide us with the medicines against the diseases that were previously considered untreatable or incurable. So, mRNA is not young. The science behind it is not young. The mRNA was discovered in 1961. It was first synthesized in a lab in 1984, and it was first tried as a therapeutic in animals in 1992. But it wasn't until 2013, when the first mRNA vaccine was tried in humans to serve as a protection against rabies, one of the scariest and most deadly diseases known to the humanity. And it wasn't until 2020 when a first mRNA vaccine was actually approved, and that was about a time when the mRNA technology came to the forefront of medicine. So, what is mRNA and how does this work? To explain that, we need to get back to something called central dogma of biology. So, as you might know, the DNA contains the genetic blueprint of our body. In its essence, it's basically who we are in terms of our genes. But DNA alone is not enough to perform all the essential functions in our body. So it needs to get transcribed into messenger RNA. And that messenger RNA needs to get translated into proteins. And proteins are the workhorses of our body, whether it's your skin cells or cells that make up your immune cells, they all need proteins. They're all made of proteins. And so when we talk about mRNA technology, it's essentially we are providing the instructions to the body to make those proteins. And for example, if you get mRNA vaccines, you essentially get a little snippet of mRNA with a harmless piece of a virus that then teaches your immune cell to recognize the real virus, and if it ever encounters it, and be able to fight with it. So why is mRNA so exciting? We heard a lot about mRNA vaccines in the past, but there is many other applications. So let's talk about a cancer. So traditionally, the cancer was treated by radiotherapy and chemotherapy, and these treatments have disadvantages. Among them is the fact that they not only damage the cancer cells, but they can also damage the healthy cells. Wouldn't it be cool, wouldn't it be amazing if you could train your immune system to only attack the cancer cells? And so this is what mRNA cancer immunotherapy allows us to do. You can take a small piece of the tumor, sequence it, and find these antigens or markers that are specific to these tumors. And then you can make a personalized mRNA vaccine that teaches your body to recognize this tumor. A good way to think about it is to think of it as Essentially, you printed out a poster called Wanted with a face of the cancer cells all over your, you know, immune system, so it can go and find these cancer cells and hopefully kill them. Sometimes some diseases are because of the fact that you're missing a vital protein or this protein is dysfunctioning. The treatment to these diseases, protein replacement therapy, does exactly that, tries to replace those proteins. The problem is that making proteins can sometimes be really complex, can be really hard to get into the body. But what mRNA allows us to do is to provide instructions to our cells to make those missing proteins. And so for the diseases such as cystic fibrosis and a number of other rare diseases, making proteins based on the instructions provided by the mRNA from outside can be a way to treat that disease. There are dozens of infectious disease vaccines being developed using mRNA technology. Diseases like Zika, influenza, mpox, HIV, people are researching mRNA vaccines against all of them. Why? Well, because mRNA vaccines can be designed very fast, in a matter of days. And this is much faster than the prior technologies. So there is a hope that for the future pandemics, you can basically quickly design the vaccine and then have it distributed all over the globe and rapidly terminate the pandemic, saving millions of lives. And kind of moving ahead, you know, we are all often talking about treatment of the disease, but how about curing diseases? So turns out some diseases arise because of the fact that some genes or some DNA in your body is faulty. And mRNA allows us to deliver these gene editing tools, for example, CRISPR-Cas9, that can correct the mistake in the gene and basically cure the disease. So this sounds pretty good, right? Where are all those medicines? Why don't we have them just yet? So turns out there is a number of bottlenecks we need to overcome before we get to this mRNA utopia. And there are kind of three areas where we need to work on: mRNA design, mRNA manufacturing, and mRNA delivery. I'm not going to talk about design and delivery. These are chapters on their own, but let's talk about mRNA manufacturing. So pretty much all the mRNA in the world today is made by a process called in vitro transcription. And it's a kind of a really complex process where you take the DNA template that kind of codes for your mRNA of interest, you put it into bacteria, you grow the bacteria, you take the DNA out of bacteria, then you put it into the soup of enzymes and cofactors and a bunch of other things, and hopefully you get some mRNA that you purify until you can put it into these little tiny carriers called lipid nanoparticles that can actually get it into your body. Oh, here is a problem. Like, does that sound complicated to you? Yeah, it's complex. And there's a couple of challenges. First of all, mRNA is very expensive. One of the reasons why it's expensive is because raw materials for the mRNA are expensive. You need a lot of DNA. You need specialist enzymes. They're not easy to source, expensive, complex supply chain, not ideal. And there is other problem. The byproducts of these reactions, such as double-stranded RNA, can make mRNA medicines potentially less safe and less efficient. And we don't want that. And as of now, we need a way to make better RNA, to make it at a bigger scale, cost-effectively, so that it can go to all the people around the globe who have a need for it. And here is where my work and work of our startup, which we co-founded with Marian Kupchalek, comes in. So I was growing up in a little village in the northwestern part of Slovakia called Nosice, and none of you probably heard of it. And I never really thought I could have any impact on humanity. But I started studying biomedical engineering, and I became obsessed by synthetic biology. It's this engineering discipline in which we are building and designing the new biological systems so we can hopefully help people. And I got really excited about, you know, programming cells. I pursued that throughout my doctoral degree at Oxford, where I used mathematical and computational modeling to investigate these biological systems. And so I could see firsthand how synthetic biology and cellular engineering could help us solve some of the problems. And the idea came by, well, your mRNA, I guess, my cells, your cells, they are making mRNA at all times. So we started thinking, could we engineer living cells and turn them into mRNA factories? So think about it just for a moment. These cells have all the machinery needed to make the mRNA, right? You don't need to give your cells nothing else, pretty much but a food. So could we re-engineer them to make that mRNA? And because these are living cells, perhaps we could engineer them to make mRNA more natural, more similar to the mRNA in our body, so it can be even more effective, and perhaps it can bring us safer and more effective mRNA medicines. And we also thought, it's pretty elegant, you know, almost imagine brewing mRNA like a beer. I think that can get people excited. And this is not really that new, right? So some of the most innovative medicines that we have today are made in cells, in living cells. In fact, the first biotechnology company called Genentech in 1982 got a product called insulin, maybe some of you are diabetics here and use it, approved. And that insulin today is made in bacteria called E. coli, that some of those strains actually live in our gut. So that's pretty remarkable. So, you know, I had this little argument with AI about how this future would look like. And I think, despite my attempts, I failed to persuade her that it will be less complex than that. So you know, dream with me just for a second. Imagine this. Imagine a future where we can make mRNA locally in a cost-efficient way, rapidly, scalably, without dependencies on complex supply chains, and most importantly, with a better quality similar to the mRNA in our bodies. Imagine that every hospital can make mRNA in its local production spot. If you're a cancer patient, perhaps you could go to that hospital, get a sample of your tumor taken out, get it sequenced, and get a personalized cancer vaccine designed on site so that you can get affordable, safe, and effective cancer treatment. Or let's take this a step further. What if every country were able to make millions of mRNA vaccines? In such a future, we would be able to combat pandemics so fast. We would rapidly design new mRNA vaccines, test them, and subsequently vaccinate the people who, quickly bring these pandemics to the end, making the world a safer place and making the global health systems more secure. But to do that, we need more than innovation. We need collaboration. So we need private investors to support and invest early stage companies and support their innovation. But we also need the public institutions and governments to play their part. They need to invest in biomanufacturing infrastructure. They need to support manufacturing initiatives. And they need to make sure that we can quickly get the mRNA medicines to the market with patient safety in our first place of the priorities. The future of medicine is bright. mRNA is at the heart of it. And we believe that by turning living cells into mRNA factories and removing the challenges of old mRNA production methods, we can make better, safer, and more affordable mRNA medicines. And I hope that this future will be joined by all of us if we work on it together. Thank you.